Okay, good. So, hi everyone, I'm Rosalind Hopwood. I'm part of the SPIRE ICT ITS team and I'm based in Imperial College. And this session is going to be about analysing SPIRE ITS spectrum and looking at sparse observations. And they're all going to be high resolution, but a lot of the stuff we're looking at is applicable to low resolution too. There's quite a few slides to get through, so I might race through them all, but you can download the presentation and then look through them at your leisure later, and hopefully there's lots of information that's useful to you in there. So I also can't progress on my... Okay, there we are. So, I'll get rid of that. Seems we're stuck with you. Are people seeing you or sharing your desktop? Oh, anyway, I'll ignore it. Okay, so this is the FTS flyer, and I think Ivan's having sound trouble when he presented this, so good to mention it again. So this is a handy A4 sheet that collates all the salient FTS information in one place, so very handy when you're doing your own analysis. And if you download the presentation, you can find a link to where that lives. There's lots of reference material for the FTS. It's all just about complete now. In particular, there's the SPIRE Data Reduction Guide and the SPIRE Handbook, and the main calibration papers that Ivan mentioned. There's also a mapping paper, which is part of a set of 5 papers that went into experiments in astronomer last summer. And amongst those, you might also be interested in the Balanchine-Schwarzschild, the relative pointing offset, which we're going to get to later. There's also a paper on SECT, on the beam profiles, and the pipeline paper. If we're getting ready to submit a new version of that, so that's going to be updated soon. So the first protocol on looking at FTS data is probably going to be the SPIRE Data Reduction Guide. Hopefully that contains most of the information that you need for looking at your data and working out if it's okay. Here are the sections we're going to be relevant to this session: the point configurations, recipes of data medium search sources, recipes of semi data sources, and spectral analysis. If you want more technical information, that's when you go to the SPIRE Handbook. If you want the up-to-date FTS uncertainties, then look at the calibration papers, but also there's a tricky page, and there's a link to that later on. And if you're working in Hive, and I do recommend it because it has lots of dedicated tasks for SPIRE, then you can look at the data analysis guide. And in particular, I find Chapter 3 on plotting quite helpful if you're working in a script, because plotting's not always obvious, and there's usually several ways to do the same thing. So the aim of the day is having a look at some FTS data and that has a few problems and trying to understand where these problems come from and then correcting them. And we'll be using SECT and also within Hype there's a suite of useful scripts which you can access via the scripts menu. And these are a handy way to help you analyze your data. So we're going to be using the background subtraction script, the Facebook print plot script, the spectral rising script, and the noise estimate script. So a quick word on these scripts. Hopefully will help facilitate your data processing and analysis. And we've designed them to be understandable, and hopefully that all the comments that you need about the scripts are in the scripts themselves. They're also easy to edit. They're not a script, one script fits all situation, but hopefully they will apply to most situations without too much editing. And they do complement each other, so you can often take the output from one script and input it into the next. So, for instance, you can background subtract a spectra, then fit the lines, then take the residual and estimate the noise. So, as Ivan already mentioned, all the level 2 data is now being processed in the archive, so you don't really need to run the pipeline. There are a few exceptions. If you wanted to say, look at the look at the intermediate steps or get the unaveraged scans because the scans are averaged, you would need to rerun the pipeline. You might also want to exclude vignetted objects from your map or regrid, but you can just grab the last few commands after the script for that. If you do want to use the pipelines, then you find them in the pipeline menu here. There's also this quite handy, this SPIRE calibration view which you access. Your Windows UView calibration, SPIRE calibration, and this gives this collects all the calibration versions, and it will tell you which is the most up to date. In this case, it's SPIRE Cal 13.1. It also gives you the release notes, so you can see what's changed with the different versions. And for this, the Hype 13 for the spectrometer, the main thing is this update of the Nan and Yang product, which corrects the issue that Van showed earlier, and I'm going to show briefly again in a few slides. But the thing to take away from this is that if you are looking at your data and it isn't type 13 processed, download it again from the archive now, and then you'll have the best data that's currently possible. So examining FDS data in HYPE, you can download it straight from the archive using use HSA equals true in the client guest observation. And when you download it, you download the observation context. It doesn't download all the data, so it won't take an age. When you click on the data, that's when it downloads it, and click on a level. So in the summary information, which is very handy, if you've been searching on the archive and you've picked an observation, you can probably, in the summary information, just check that it's the sort of observation you're after. You can check that it's HYPE 13 reduced and the resolution and the map sampling, etc. There's also this useful browse product image, and if you click on that, it will expand, and you can have a look to see if there's any obvious problems with the spectrum. So are there any problems? Not for this one. This is actually for sparse observation, it plots the sensing vectors. But for this one, this is an observation of NGC 787. This looks good. So let's move on to if you do see a problem. So if you do see a problem with your spectrum, then the first protocol is the SPI data reduction guide. It helps to give you advice on what you should then do. And we're going to look at a plot from 7.6 in the section, does my spectrum need correcting? And there's a handy diagnostic plot in there, and this is it. So there are three situations where you may find significant issues with your spectrum. So the first one here, this is a point source. So this is all point source calibrated data. So the first is a point source embedded in the background and the foreground. And what you'll find is that there'll be a jump between the bands, a bit of a wiggle, and extra fringing. So the second situation is that there's been a significant pointing offset. And again, there's a jump in the band. You can't see it too well because if you're on it, it's very bright, but there's a wiggle and there's extra fringing. And the third case is where you have a partially extended source, and then neither calibration is appropriate, and so you get this jump in the band, a bit of a wiggle, extra fringing. So you probably guess that all three situations create pretty much the same issue in the spectrum. So it's important to try and separate out the causes, because the correction for one is very different to the correction between three, and you need to correct two and three separately. So you need to separate out these issues. Of course, it may not be possible, in which case I would say try and work out what the most significant issue is and correct that. We're going to look at an example for each of these situations in the next few slides. So this fourth issue, Ivan already brought up, so I'm going to go through this pretty quickly. It's the non-linearity update, which corrects particularly observations that were taken at the beginning. Yes, operation days on the going for the coolery cycle. And you should find now that in HYPE 13 it's a nice smooth spectrum, whereas in HYPE 12 SLW is drooping. And we have found there are a few rare exceptions. You tend to be below the 500. And then you may find this SLW still drooping. If you see this, do contact the help desk and we'll try and collect the data for you. So let's get on to these examples with problems. First one is point source embedding and extended emission. And I've picked the same source as you saw in that diagnostic plot, AFGL-406. This is a medium strength source, continuing up to about 40 Janskis. Again, looking at the point source calibrated data here, and downloading the observation using use HSA equals true. I'm looking in the observation context, you can see it's hopefully reduced, and it's high resolution, sparse observation. And then we look at the browse images, are there any problems? Well, yes, we already know that there were problems with this spectrum. So there's this jump between the bands, the poor shape in the continuum of SLW, and there's this extra fringing. And the extra fringing comes on because the extended emission is folded into this point source emission, and then it's calibrated as a point source, which leads to these problems. SLW is more strongly affected because it has a larger beam size, up to about two times that of SSW, so it takes in more of the background. And what we'll do here is try and correct the wide scale shape of the continuum. So you can use the first useful script we're going to use is the spectrometer array footprint plot script. This takes a photometric overlay of the FPS footprint. Now the script is an update for HYPE 13, and that is the script now looks in the metadata, and it looks for photobs IDs, so these are new for HYPE 13, and those list all the photometer observations that overlap with the spectrometer observations, so you don't have to go digging on the archive for that, they're in the metadata. And the script we're using is there. Of course, you can enter your own photometer map, but do pick one that's sub-millimeter wavelength if possible, because it needs to be sensitive to the same wavelength as the FDS. And you can use this to have a look at the background, see if there's a background or if there's any nearby sources. So just looking at the full figure, this is taken from Hotwood et al. 2015, this compares a point source, CRL 618, a point source in the background, and a semi-sended source, NGC 632, which we'll use later, the semi-sended example. And you can see comparing the center regions that these two look very similar. This is what a point source looks like, and this is obviously got more extent. But you can see ASGL 416 is sitting in this background. If you actually examine the IRAS image of this, you can see it's galactic cirrus. Now, I don't know if you can see the little red arrow, but that is in fact where ASGL 416 is sitting. This is obviously a huge picture compared to this one. So let's go on to try and correct this spectrum, and we'll use the useful script, the spectrum to background subtraction script. Now this takes the off-axis detectors, which are shown here. These are the black detectors in the honeycomb barometer array layout. Now the script uses the first ring of SLW, and the second ring of SSW doesn't use the first ring. And it smooths the off-axis detectors and plots them all. The script has an interactive, by default, it has an interactive aspect to it. So it will smooth these with a wide gaping kernel, and then it plots all of them, and then it asks you, it goes to each one, and it says, do you want this detector excluded? And this way you can get rid of outliers, because there can be some very significant outliers due to clipping. And there aren't any particularly outlying detectors here, but let's say let's exclude this one when we want to do the script. So it just takes an input, the point source calibrated spectrum. You can also input a dark sky if you want to subtract, but that is possible to use the off-axis detectors. And then the output's the subtracted spectrum. So here we have the and it's off-axis comparison for you. So here we have the red data is the original, and we can see that after subtracting the off-axis detectors, an average of the off-axis detectors, we get this green spectrum, which the jump has been corrected. The shape is improved. Of course, you still have the fringing because this is just subtracting the wide scale shape correction. But that's a pretty good result. And of course, you'll be able to do line fitting to this much more easily now because you can fit a polynomial wouldn't have fitted to the shape particularly well. So just a word of caution about this script. If you look in Hotwood 2015 for more details, there is a section on the off-axis detectors. And in fact, there's real flux in these detector rings. Not very much. If we look at point sources, Uranus and Neptune, this is the average percentage in the center detectors. It's approximately 2% in the first ring SLW. There isn't really anything in the second ring of SLW. This missing bit is accounted for in point source calibration. So your point source calibrated spectra aren't missing it. Once you subtract the off-axis detectors, you're subtracting off around about 2% in SLW. Obviously, there's lots more flux for semi-extended source, so NGC 602, we can see the points here are actually off the Y scale. But what you need to do is consider whether or not subtracting off this 2% of real flux is worthwhile, and I think in this case it certainly is, because you get this nice shape, which is going to be much easier to fit lines to. So moving on to the second example, this is where we're collecting a pointing offset. This is a point source. This is picking AFGL 2688, and we can see from this plot, if you look at the points for AFGL 2688, they're very, very similar to Uranus and Neptune, so it's basically a point source. And we download again in the same using the same command, and again it's type 13 reduced, and we'll look at the browse product. And we can see that there is this jump between the bands. So we know this is a point source, we know there isn't a significant background, so in this case, the jump must be due to a pointing offset. So we've been able to identify what the cause is. We want to correct the jump between the bands. Now, we need to know what that pointing offset is. So we can firstly look in the metadata. And the two keywords in the metadata of interest here, this is RSF offset and BSM offset. And A gives information on the known pointing offset. The AP is still associated, so the random error on the pointing is still associated to these values. So let's get the full description because they're quite long, you can't see them in the screenshot. So the RSF offset provides the offset between the position that's selected by the observer and the actual place that Herschel was pointing at, to our best knowledge at the current time. And this includes any systematic BSM offset, which you'll find in BSM offset keyword. Now this records either 0 or 1.2 7 out of 7 seconds, depending on the date. So before OD10011, there was the BFM was at a slight offset of 1.72 seconds, and that was corrected for any date after OD10011. So that's just new type for a second, and we can print out these values. So here is the ROADEC offset, here is the BFM offset value, and when it comes to looking at your data, this is the actual offset that your data is suffering from, because the point source calibration corrects this 1.72. So there's another method to get the pointing offset, and that's written up in Baltanov et al. 2014, and that's a relative pointing method. And this is where you take a reference observation, so the one with the highest continuum, and you assume that's got no zero offset, and then you use it to correct all the others. So you do need lots of repeated observations for this method to work. And for these cases, correct, you need to actually keep the BFM offset in there. So although the point source calibration does correct that, SECT automatically decorrects. So you need to keep it in there. So you need to use the full values when using SECT. So we have these two values, 3.37 and 6.21, which we can now use with the semi-extended correction tool. So this is actually called the semi-extended corrector in the task menu, and this is the GUI for it, and it takes as an input the point source calibrated spectrum and the calibration context. You can put in the beam profile separately, but I recommend using the full calibration context. There are some options, so if you want it to make plots, then you have to do plots, you can optimize diameter. If you want the correction out rather than the corrected spectrum, you then tick apply correction. And you can also set the reference beam values with here. Let's just have a quick look at the reference beam. So here's a graphical representation of what the reference beam does. So the reference beam is used to normalize the spectrum for the output, is equivalent to a spectrum reserve with a frequency independent Gaussian beam. And what happens is this dashed line represents the reference beam, and any emission outside of this is excluded from the final spectrum. The default is 40 forward half maximum, 40 out seconds to match SLW. But you can set the forward half maximum to match another telescope so you can compare the data sets. If you want to remove the effect of the reference beam, just set the forward half maximum to a large number, and then all the emission will be included inside the reference beam. So the other thing is to import the source distribution model. And within the GUI, you have a choice of a Gaussian top hat and facet profile. You can set an X or Y offset for when you're correcting for pointing offset. You just need to pick one of these. It doesn't matter which one. And the profile is then shown of the model. The source distribution model is then shown down here and overlaid with the FTF array footprint. Now, the errors do increase the source models larger than necessary, being to recommend really only doing this for sources that are smaller than the SSW beam size. And once you get to about 60 odd seconds, you may as well just use the extended data. And you can input a point source by using a Gaussian model and setting it down to 0.01. And of course, you can have greater control of the set using this script. And SECT does these internal, it internally considers that there's an offset between SLW and C3 and SSW4 and this BSM offset. So you don't need to worry about it, but you just need to make sure you're putting in the right value, the pointing offset. So let's correct the observation of AFGL 2688 with the script. The first thing to do is load up the calibration context, then get the point source calibrated products from the calibration, the observation context. And this name, if you have older data, you may find that this name is different. Again, this is indication you need to download the FAC 13 data, so this command will work. Also, then you need to consummate the model image. This is a source distribution model. You can use semi-extended source model shape. Here we set a Gaussian at 6.6 forward half maximum with one of the offsets mentioned earlier. And then you can run the semi-extended corrector. And this was done with dplots equals one, so you can see the plots. Now, if you want more information about SECT, more complicated situations, and there's also a script available, go to a workshop from last year. And then there's two presentations and a script that you can pick up. So here are the results. SECT plots these the corrected spectrum She's wearing the green compared to the unconnected perspective, and she's the, what is that, teal? I don't know. And blue. And this, and we can just see when we're using the offset from the metadata, which is frequency 7, the step between the boundaries is reduced. The step is removed when using the relative offset. And that's expected because obviously it gives a more accurate result, but we need all these lots of observations, so it's not something that you can use from any sources. So if you know you've got a point source, then you can actually correct, or you can play with this value until you get a good match in the bounds. Not a point source. If you know there isn't any other issue, one of the issues. Oh yes, a point source. Sorry. Okay. So one thing you might want to consider is that the RA index requested by the observer might not actually be at submillimeters, and this could be what's happening in this case. So we're seeing that the metadata offset, although the APE is still attached, it may be underestimated because of this reason. But this is a nice result. At this point we're going to move on to a source of the partially extended morphology, NGC-6302, which we saw earlier. This is the butterfly nebula, and see some nice little images of it. So again, we download the data, we look at the summary information, it's height 13, good. High rare, it's sparse, good. So let's look at the, if we have a quick look at the metadata, we can see that this is taken after OD1011, so the VSM offset is zero, and the RA deck offset is very small, so we can say for this observation there isn't a pointing offset. If we look at the bars image, obviously there's this large jump between the bands, and we can see that there's a problem. So we know that there's no real offset, we know it's not in a significant background, so this is because of its partially extended nature. So as Ivan already mentioned, the reason this happens is because we have two extreme versions of our calibration. We have point-like calibration, we have extended calibration. So if there's a source that's semi-extended, it's here, so neither calibration work. Whereas if we point source calibrate point-like source, that works very nicely. Calibrate an extended source with extended calibration, that works very nicely. So that's what we've got here with NGC-6302. We have a very similar looking spectrum for the point source calibration data. So moving on to correcting NGC-6302 with SECT. Now the SECT algorithm is based on the forward coupling distribution, the source distribution, so really knowing your source well is key to getting good results out. And the better you know your source, the better results are going to be when it comes to inputting the source distribution model. So here just use the default settings. So that's a Gaussian, forward half maximum of 18 arc seconds. A little bit eccentric, and no X or Y offset. But setting optimized amateur equals true to see what SECT decides is the best model data. So looking at the plots that SECT produces, it plots the correction, and this is the value you can get out if you set the pi correction equals zero. And that's what you get out in the corrected spectrum in that case, not the corrected spectrum itself. When you're optimizing diameter, SECT also plots the different steps that it tries with diameter. Here it's settled on 18.5 arc seconds, it's the green spectrum. It's useful to be able to see what steps it's tried when it's minimizing. It minimizes looking at the overlap region. And it also plots the, as I said before, the corrected and the uncorrected spectrum. So here we can see this is the result. So there isn't a jump anymore, but I think looking at the center, because this is where it's minimized, actually it's crossing a bit. So I think there's probably room for improvement here, and in which case we really do need a better knowledge of the source model. So that's why it's important to getting the best results out. But this is a good result, so we can move on. For line fitting. So we're going to move on and we're going to fit lines to this corrected spectrum. So we can use the useful script, the spectrum for line fitting script, and this plots sync profiles to each of the lines and polynomial with the continuum, and it does this simultaneously, and then it gives you a curve detector, and it gives you this nice plot where you've got the spectrum in blue, the total model in red, and the residual in green, so you can see how many lines you've missed. So let's move on to our example, NGC-6302. Now, actually, talking about the script for a second, you can see the section in the DRG, section 7.11, and that gives details on the script. There's also other comments in the script itself, and some. So hopefully that's enough information for you to edit it if you need to. But here's a quick summary. So a third owner following a regime is the continuum. Now the continuum is usually well approximated by a polynomial, but you can see when it fits in the background, sometimes in a funny shape, and it may not fit so well. So you need to check that. Only the 12 show lines included as default in the script. Obviously, you can add your own more lines to the list that are already there, or you can read in the text file. And the script will tell you how to do that. There's some pointed outlines on how to do that. The FDS unresolved instrumental line shape is approximately a sync. It's a good approximation. So the script fixes the widths using actual resolution from the metadata. Now, if your lines are partially resolved, even if you unfix that width, it's not going to give you a good fit. In fact, it will hardly change the width at all. So you need, in that case, to use a sync Gauss profile, but only for lines of the width greater than 2 to a second. If they're less than that, you don't really need to use it, and also there's a problem with the sync Gauss function, the way it cuts up abruptly in the wings, and if you don't subtract the wings very well, and leaves lots of noise in your spectrum. So you get the script from one with point source, or extended source calibrated spectrum, you're running it with point source calibrated spectrum, and you can input things like redshift, source velocity. If you want a redshift out, a redshift system out, you do need to adjust the script, the script will tell you how to do that. So here are the results from running the default script, so just for the 12 CL lines, you can see the polynomials fitted very nicely to the continuum. The 12 CL lines have been fitted, but there were all these extra lines in there. Most of them are 13 CL lines. There's a few strong lines, and that could well be affecting the fit to this 12 CL line. Also, we can see the fringing that's left from the poor calibration of the semi-extended nature of the source. So it's a good start, but really, we need to go back and fit more lines. So let's do that and see. We fit the 12 show lines, and a few extra, then we can see we get a much cleaner residual. And when it comes to taking the noise estimate, which is going to be in a moment, then this is very important to get a good measure of the spectral noise. The script outputs the line blocks, error on the line blocks, and the velocity, and error on the velocity, and you can save that to a text file. So quick word after dive data, then if each observation comes with after dive data, it is good for checking lines. So if you have a source like this with a lot of lines, you can go in, and because the data is effectively being smooth by the optimization, you can check to see which lines are real and which is actually the wings of your sync function. However, we highly recommend that you don't take line measurements from the after dive data. You should really be taking measurements from the standard data after picking sync functions, because that will give you the most accurate results. So moving on to the noise, there's lots of information about noise in the DRG, the SPIRE handbook, on the public tricky 2 there's a page, and you can go to the calibration papers. But here's a quick summary. So there are three main sources of uncertainty in FDS data. One is the random noise, which will break down in integration time, and that dominates main sources. Then we have systematic noise associated with the instrument, but there's also small-scale systematic noise associated with the lines themselves. So sources with strong lines, this tends to dominate. Measuring your spectral noise is a way to check how well your data has been processed. And you can't really do this with the error column, because this only represents the random noise. It's the statistical error, scatter of the scans, the random error on the mean of all scans. But we can use the usual script estimate noise, the spectral noise, to estimate the noise directly from the data. You should do this after subtracting lines, as you see. You can use a line picking script to subtract the lines and get the residual. Now, for faint sources and line subtracted data, the noise should at least be as good as HBOT. And the noise estimate script does plot a comparison with HBOT, which we'll see in a second. So there is this page, this public cookie page, that goes through the spectrum of uncertainties, but it is repeating what's in the published papers, but it's a useful place where it's collected, along the potometer uncertainties. So moving on to using the usual script, the spectrometer noise estimate script, with the NGC, the observation NGC 1602 that we saw before. So the script bins up the data, subtracts the baseline, and then takes the standard deviation within a frequency bin, I think it's 50 gigahertz. So here's the data. The results of the data downloaded straight from the archive, you get this green line, you can see it's absolutely dominated by noise, by lines. gives this zigzag pattern. So this is the uncorrected spectrum. So if we do a corrected spectrum, here we can see it's actually, the noise has actually gone up. And that's because the spectrum goes up, because obviously when you correct with the same thing, then the spectrum goes up. And this is a multiplicative effect, so it increases the noise. So let's look at the residual when you're running the default script. So this is where just the 12 CO lines were fitted and subtracted, and we can see we've still got this zigzag, and this is that strong line that was missed. You can see in the residual here. So let's go back to the final one we had with the line script, where lots of the lines, most of the lines have been subtracted, all the significant lines that we could see. And you can see here now this much smoother noise, and now it's obvious to see that it's kicking up at the high frequency end. So this is the fringing, the extra fringing, due to the problem with the initial semi-extended nature and the calibration. But and although it's not hitting the H spot, what you can probably see is that if you compare the red to the blue, bottom of the blue, and then you were to shift that down to the relative to the bottom of the green, it would in fact hit the H spot. So in fact, this spectrum, once we've corrected the semi-extended nature, is doing okay. So I think I'm just about getting to the end of my time slot, but a quick word on another comparison with the photometer, this time in comparing photometry. So if you've taken some photometry from a photometer map, you can then compare it to the spectrum of the same source. And you can do this using SPIRE-SINCE photometry task. Now, it used to be called SPECMAP Spot. Now it's called SPIRE-SINCE photometry. And this takes the input, you have the input photometry value for the photometer yourself, but it will take a point source calibrated spectrum or an extended calibrated spectrum and derive a synthetic photometry at the photometer wavebands. And then it will make this nice plot to compare them. And we can hear the photometer points, which are the green ones, we're taking the timeline fitter, which accounts, subtracts the background. So this is the pre background subtracted AFGL 4106 observation. We see that the match isn't very good. But once we do the background subtraction, then we get a really good match between the two photometer points. These grey lines, by the way, are the photometer RTF. And this output in a table data set by the task, where you've got the detectors and then the synthetic photometry and the errors and the photometry. So getting on to the summary. So I hope you've taken on board that if you don't have Hype 13 data, then do go and update it from the HSA as soon as possible. If you are looking at FTS data, then keep the data reduction guide, the SPIRE data reduction guide on hand, because that's always going to help your first call when you run into a problem or you need extra information. We came across three situations where there can be a problem with the data in the background, with the pointing offset, or the semi-extended nature, and these can all cause a similar issues for the spectrum, and it's important to separate out these issues. You can correct the background using the off-axis, the background subtraction script, and that can be effective for point-like sources, but it's not a good idea. In fact, you shouldn't use it for semi-extended sources. Pointing offsets can be correctly set, however, there is going to be a new dedicated point correction task for Hype 14. It's based on set, but it will be simpler than just for pointing correction. And then we got onto the fact that you have a partially extended source, the calibration is not good, and you do need to correct semi-extended nature, and you should do that in set. But you do need a good understanding of the source to get out sensible results. When it comes to fitting lines to your collected data or any of the FES spectrum, you can fit all the lines at once using sync profiles if they're not resolved and continuing simultaneously. And the useful scripts hopefully provide a handy workflow within Hype. And I'd just like to finish by saying that really the best place to FES data to inspect, diagnose, correct and analyse is within Hype. It has lots of dedicated tasks and it has these scripts and lots of documentation. Hopefully, that is the best place to work, only to play your data, then go and take your favourite software. Okay, so that's everything for me.